Thanks, Pat. My talk today is really about unpacking the results from a national monitoring program that was put together to look at the effects of the release of RHDV K5 across the country in 2017. So I'd just like to acknowledge all my co-authors in my talk today. There's quite a list of them, and that's because when you're putting out a national monitoring program, there's a lot of people involved, and none of this would have been possible without them. So thanks to everyone for all their input on this particular talk today. So just a little bit of background, and most of this has already been covered by both Robin and Tanya. But as we know, RHDV, introduced in Australia in 1996, was initially very successful, especially in arid areas of Australia, where there was up to 80% reductions in rabbit abundance. However, RHDV was... Sorry about that. Phone went off. Sarah, we also know that RHDV was less successful in coastal areas of Australia, and that was put down to high prevalence of a benign calicivirus, this RCVA1. And it was since shown that RCVA1 conferred sort of partial immunity to infection to RHDV. So given those sort of circumstances, there was a search for new strains of RHDV began in 2009, and this was to try and find a strain of RHDV that could potentially overcome this partial immunity issue. And eventually a strain, RHDV K5, was found and selected and registered as a biological control agent in 2016. And RHDV K5 was selected because it seemed to perform better at overcoming the partial immunity issue with RCVA1. Subsequently, K5 was released in a national program at over 300 sites in autumn of 2017. So meanwhile, as has been spoken of previously, this new RHDV variant, RHDV2, emerged in Europe, discovered in 2010, rapidly spread there to become the dominant strain. It was first reported in Australia in 2015, but was probably here a little bit before that. And unlike RHDV, RHDV2 can infect juvenile rabbits, so rabbits less than sort of 5 weeks of age, which gave it a bit of a competitive advantage there. And so there were some questions about what the potential was of RHDV2 potential to hamper the release of RHDV K5. So basically the objectives of the monitoring program was to use monitoring data to look at the impact of this national release of RHDV K5 in 2017. And this was undertaken on a series of paired release and non-release sites across the country. We could also use the same data to look at the impact of RHDV2 because it arrived at all of these sites at various times during the monitoring program. So we have some sites with the monitoring data that had pre-RHDV2 arrival data, and some sites where it arrived pretty much where monitoring data coincided with the RHDV2 arrival. And so sites with monitoring data pre-RHDV2 arrival, we could look at that and see what the potential effects were on the subsequent release of RHDV K5. We also collected serological data, and this was to examine changes in seroprevalence of all the different strains as much as we could. So just a little bit about the rabbit monitoring data itself. We had 18 sites spread across the country, and these were organised into 9 pairs. And one of the pair was designated an RHDV K5 release site, and one was a non-release site. And as mentioned, K5 was released across the country, including the 9 release sites in this monitoring program in March 2017. Each of our monitoring sites was monitored 4 times a year, principally by using spotlight counts, so three consecutive nights of spotlighting. And also rabbit serum samples were collected from up to 20 rabbits in each of these in each of these four monitoring periods. Most sites were monitored since 2014 or 2015. However, there's a couple of sites with a longer time series having monitoring data from 2011. This is a map showing the locations of all the 18 monitoring sites. So there was two sites in southern Queensland, six sites in New South Wales, two sites in the ACT, four sites in Victoria, two in South Australia, and two in Western Australia. So we had national coverage, but fairly good coverage of sort of southeastern Australia in particular. Now I'll go through what we how the data were analysed. Because we had time series of sort of spotlight counts, we could fit some time series models to these data, and in particular, a model that we fitted was called a state-space model. Because we had replicate counts during each monitoring period, we could correct the spotlight counts for rabbits that were missed during monitoring, so corrected for imperfect detection. The particular state-space model we fitted was, allowed us to fit a population dynamics model, which allowed for density dependence. And this allowed us to estimate population growth rates. Particularly, we looked at population growth rate between each quarterly monitoring period. And that allowed us to look at the effect of RHDV2 arrival on population growth and also the effect of the release of K5 on population growth. Another thing we looked at is equilibrium or average rabbit abundance, both before RHDV2 arrival and post RHDV2 arrival, and the same for K5. And so these are parameters that were estimated by these time series models. So just go through some results and what the analysis and what the monitoring data looked like. There's a bit going in with this slide, but I'll just walk you through it. So this is the results from monitoring data from two sites in New South Wales. And on the left-hand side, we have the site where K5 was released. On the right-hand side, we have the site where was the non-release site, the paired non-release site. The top row is the rabbit spotlight monitoring data and analysis, and the bottom row is the seroprevalence of RHDV in black and RHDV2 in orange. Just focusing in on the top row, we can see a series of sort of small open circles. That's the raw spotlight monitoring data. And the solid black line is the population trajectory estimated by the time series model, with the grey shaded area being the uncertainty in that trajectory. So we've got a red vertical line here, which indicates the arrival time of RHDV2 at this site based on serology, and also the blue vertical line indicates the RHDV K5 release sites. There's also some other vertical lines there. You can see, horizontal lines. We can see this green vertical line. This is the average abundance of equilibrium abundance before RHDV2 arrival. And the orange line here is the average abundance post RHDV2 arrival. So these are the parameters estimated by the time series models. And so the difference between them is effectively the impact of RHDV2 on the rabbit population. And we also did the same pre and post the K5 release. So for this particular site, we can see there was quite a large impact of RHDV2 arrival, indicated by the difference between those two horizontal lines, but probably not much of an impact of the release of K5 at this particular site. Just an example, here's the same data again for another pair of sites in South Australia. Again, we can see that there was seemed to be an impact of the arrival of RHDV2 at this site, but over here while there was an impact of RHDV2, didn't seem to be an impact of the release of K5 in terms of rabbit abundance. You can see down here the sort of reciprocal relationship we have between the seroprevalence of RHDV, which includes K5 and RHDV2. So what we really know was what was the overall effect from all 18 monitoring sites. So this is sort of summarised in this, this graph here. So this is the estimates of average quarterly population growth rates in rabbits from all 18 sites organised by states. Over on the y-axis, we've got change in population growth rate with the horizontal dashed line indicating a zero line, so no change indicated by that line. The purple bars are the change in population growth rate for sites where we had at least 1 year of monitoring data prior to RHDV2 arrival at that site. The brown bars have less than 1 year monitoring data. You can see over in the far right-hand side the overall effect of the arrival of RHDV2 on population growth. And averaged over all sites, reduction in population growth rate amounted to about a 40% reduction. And we can see that sites that had at least a year's monitoring data prior to arrival of RHDV2 had slightly higher impacts on population growth. But more noticeably, which is not quite detailed here, was the impact on average rabbit abundance. At those sites where we had sufficient pre-arrival monitoring data, the reduction in average rabbit abundance amounted to 60%. Consequently, we also looked at the effect of the release of RHDV K5. So this is the same data. The red bars are the K5 release sites, and the black bars are the non-release sites. You can see there's really only evidence of the impact of the K5 release at one site in Queensland. And overall, in terms of change in population growth rates, there was really no discernible impact of the release of K5 at these sites anyway. So just look at some serological analysis quickly. So because we had several strains of RHDV, including K5, RHDV2, and also the benign calicivirus, we looked at multivariate versions of these state-based models. And this allowed us to look at interactions among strains. However, because we're looking at serology, there were significant levels of cross-reactivity amongst the various competition analyzers. So diagnostically, serological testing could only distinguish what I'm calling the RHDV strain. So this includes RHDV and RHDV K5, RHDVA, all those sort of first generation RHDVs that are fairly similar. So serologically, we couldn't distinguish between each of these strains. So we really don't know what became of K5 in terms of serology. All we know is that we could track seroprevalence of RHDV. However, we could detect in the serology seroprevalence of RHDV2 and also the benign calicivirus. So we could look at interactions amongst these three nominal strains in terms of the effects on strain seroprevalence.
1 minute.
Yep. Just wrapping up now, last couple of slides. So here's the overall trends in strain seroprevalence for RCV-A1, RHDV and RHDV2. You can see the x-axis here is time since RHDV2 arrival. So you can see clear negative trends in adult seroprevalence in both RCV-A and RHDV. With increasing seroprevalence of RHDV2. There were also declines in juvenile seroprevalence. So juvenile seroprevalence is a good indicator of recent infection. And you can see that in the first 2 years since RHDV2 arrived at a particular site, seroprevalence declined. But then we can see this uptick in juvenile seroprevalence indicating recent infection. So it was still bubbling along, but there was basically no flow-on effects in terms of increasing adult seroprevalence. So in conclusion, it seemed pretty clear that incursion of RHDV2 reduced rabbit abundance by about 60%. Results were quite patchy, though. Higher in South Australia and Western Australia, and also some parts of New South Wales. Conversely, the release of the RHDV K5 largely failed to have the anticipated impact at our monitored sites. And this was basically due to suppression of rabbit populations by RHDV2. So it was clear from the serological analysis and the analysis of the spotlight monitoring data that RHDV2 basically impacted the ability of both the benign calicivirus and RHDV to spread within rabbit populations. And this has been talked about before, how RHDV2 can infect juvenile rabbits less than 5 weeks of age. So this removes them from the pool of susceptible individuals, and so they're no longer able to be infected by RHDV. So this gives RHDV2 a distinct competitive advantage. And the other thing is RHDV2 can also overcome previous infection by RHDV. The serology suggests that RHDV2 was replacing RHDV, and some of Robin's talks have basically indicated that this has become more widespread across the country. So RHDV is only in a few places, mainly in WA at present time. So I'll leave it there. It's been interesting to see how the long-term outcomes of the strain competition will play out over the longer term. So we'll keep an eye on that. And I'll leave it there and take any questions if there's time. Thanks very much.